Bullen picked up the bottle and tipped it, even though he knew it was empty, a look of innocent surprise on his square face.
When the rumour got out that he was in difficulties, he was doomed. Every depositor was at the door a-hammering to get their monies out. No bank can stand that, regardless of how well it's run.
Bullen shook his head at the folly of his fellow humans.
Which is why, sir, I never trust my own humble stipend to their greedy hands. I've collared too many bankers in my time to trust the breed. And I know, whatever they say, that they has monies tucked away, even if they are in jail. Just let the turmoil subside, then they settle their pressing debts and walk off to a life of ease and comfort.
Another bottle, said James. He suspected that Bullen had invented the last statement, but necessity meant he'd have to follow it up, and that was something that couldn't be achieved without the means to lubricate the under-sheriff's throat.
Oh, I don't know that I should, Your Honour,
Bullen replied. This said in the way that people employ when they fully expect their feeble protest to be ignored. James rang the bell, then walked onto the landing to call down. Marsh was still outside the door, his pockmarked face set in a scowl that looked habitual.
You're a thief-taker, I'm told.
I am that,
Marsh replied, in a voice that exactly matched the face, low in the throat, rumbling, and very unfriendly. Who found it necessary to follow me last night after I came ashore?
I had to make sure I could direct Mr. Bullen to the right abode, didn't I?
James was thinking how amusing it would be to put Villiers onto this fellow's tail. Marsh's reaction adding spice to the image when Ben Harper arrived with the fresh port bottle. The way the boy looked at Marsh was singular indeed.